this part of thermodynamics 2, we will be dealing with ideal gas cycles. Before that, we move on to the second law of thermodynamics and also the first law of thermodynamics. So in the first law of thermodynamics, it was stated that energy is a conserved property. 2. Total amount of energy lost by an object or substance is equal to the amount gained by another substance. 3. No process is known have taken place in the violation of the first law of thermodynamics. 4. A process must satisfy first law to occur. Process proceed in a certain direction and not in the reverse direction. That's first law. So here I have two examples related to the principle of conservation of energy or the first law of thermodynamics. So from this diagram, we got to know that the total energy input must be equal to the energy output plus the energy storage. So the differences between the energy input and the energy output, we have energy storage. Second example, here you have hot coffee and the cold environment. So heat flows from the hot coffee to the cool environment, and that results in the rise in temperature of the surrounding air or the environment. And from the coffee, you have a drop in temperature. So based on this figure or diagram, we have energy, the total energy loss from the hot coffee must be equal to the total energy gain by the environment. So these are the two examples of the principle of conservation of energy. So the first law places no restriction on the direction of a process. But satisfying the first law does not ensure that the process can actually occur. The insufficiency or inadequacy of first law to identify whether a process can take place is resolved by introducing another principle that is called the second law. That is when the second law comes in. A process cannot occur unless it satisfies both the first and the second laws of thermodynamics. So in order to do that, you must have to include first law and second law. Second law of thermodynamics is not limited to identify the direction of processes. The second law also asserts that energy has, means second law includes or says that or states that it has, energy has quality and as well as quantity based on second law. So the first law is concerned with quantity of energy and the transformation of energy from one form to another with no regard of its quality. That is based on first law. So in second law provides the necessary means to determine the quality as well as the degree of degradation of energy during a process. That's second law. Now, please take note that in general, the second law of thermodynamics, which is also a natural law, indicates that in any complete cycle, the gross heat supply must be greater than the network output so that there is a certain amount of heat rejected. The heat engine and thermal efficiency. Now, thermal efficiency is to measure, is one of the way to measure the quality of the energy. So, example, you have high temperature source, example, as solar, furnace, geothermal, and steam power or steam energy. So that forms as the source. Then you have this total energy supply or total gross heat supply to the heat engine. Heat engine utilize a certain amount of or convert a certain amount, only convert a certain amount of the heat energy supplied to it to produce, okay, work output. And other than that, okay, the remainder will have to be rejected to what we call a sink, that is low temperature region. That is a low temperature region, example, river, pond, cooling tower, and etc. etc. Now, so you have work output. Okay, so based on energy balance, we have the total or the gross heat supply must be equal to the amount of energy, heat energy rejected, and the net work out. So, thermal energy reservoirs, the source. Now, in the development of second law of thermodynamics, it is very convenient to have a hypothetical body with a relative large thermal energy capacity that can supply or absorb finite amounts of heat without undergoing any change in temperature. Such a body is called a thermal energy reservoir, that which is formed as the source of heat energy. Heat engines. Now, and heat, an engine or device which converts heat energy to work, is known as a heat engine. So first, they receive heat from high temperature source such as solar energy, oil furnace, nuclear reactor, and etc. etc. That they convert part of this heat to work, usually in the form of rotating shaft. They reject the remaining waste heat to a low temperature, which we call sink, that is the atmosphere, river, and etc. etc. They operate on a cycle. Heat engines and other cyclic devices usually involve a fluid to and from which heat is transferred while undergoing a cycle. This fluid is called the working fluid or a system. Thermal efficiency. Thermal efficiency is defined as the desired output over required input. The desired output, as for example a refrigerator, is to have a cooling effect. The required input, which is the power input, which is an example. Okay, so the desired output of the heat engine is the network output, and the required input is the total heat supply or the gross heat supply from the reservoir or the source. No heat engines can have a thermal efficiency of 100%, or as for a power plant to operate, the working fluid must exchange heat with the environment as well as the furnace. So no heat engines can ever give us an efficiency of 100%. So that is why we have heat rejected. Nearly all motive power is derived from heat using some form of heat engines. For example, heat engines, for examples, are the steam power plant, gas turbines, jet engines, internal combustion engines, and the external combustion engines. ideal cycle. So what is the ideal cycle? A cycle that resembles the actual cycle closely, but is made up totally of internal reversible processes is called an ideal cycle. So these are the PV diagrams before we go into learning how to draw all the PV and TS diagrams of the standard cycles. We have to know, okay, the temperature line, the entropy line, pressure line, and volume line on a PV and a TS diagram. So I have shown you here PV diagram with entropy line and PV diagram with temperature lines or curves. So as you can see, the entropy line is much, the entropy lines are much steeper as compared to the temperature line or curve. Then you have the TS diagram for volume and the TS diagram for pressure. So as you can see on the TS diagram, both the TS diagram, you can see the highest volume V4, which is the minimum volume. But as you refer to TS diagram with pressure curve or lines, you can see that P4 is actually the highest pressure. So and we know that pressure and volume, they are inverse. So when the pressure is maximum, the volume is minimum in this case, especially in a isolated piston cylinder device. So these are some examples before we go into detail in detail of every each of this cycle. This is some of the diagrams that shows Carnot auto cycle, constant pressure diesel cycle, and the rest at the back. So each of these cycles here consists of four processes. So each of the cycle consists of four processes, but mainly you can see that consists of isentropic process or an adiabatic or adiabatic processes. So these are the examples: Carnot, Otto, constant pressure cycle, and diesel cycle. We'll be discussing these in detail in the later slides. So these are another three. These are the other three of the heat engine cycles, air standard cycles, which are the dual combustion cycle, Stirling cycle, and the Erickson cycle. So for the time being, this is the end of my presentation. We continue next slides. These are the references. You can take your time to look at it. These are actually the applications of thermodynamics, area of application. Thank you very much.